beer. You got it.
My name is Andrew Daniel.
And I'm Black Angus. And today we'll be reviewing Deadpool 2. Deadpool 2 takes place 2 years after the first movie. We follow Wade Wilson, who's been a successful mercenary, and living with his girlfriend, Vanessa, happily. They hope to build a family together when trouble ensues, causing Wade to have to find a new purpose. Mm. So, Andrew, what were some of the things you loved about this movie?
I definitely agree that it was funnier than the first one. The thing about that, though, is it's more about the quality of the joke as opposed to the quantity. The first one definitely seemed to kind of rapidly fire off jokes. And a lot of them were pretty funny, but this one, it just kind of, it may not have rapidly fired them, but they were definitely a lot better. So it definitely kind of seems like there was more thought put into kind of the attitude of Deadpool. The action was also definitely a lot better. And I really liked a lot of the casting. You know, I don't want to necessarily go into too much detail because we got the notes kind of breaking down, like, what do you think of Domino? What do you think of so-and-so? But I definitely think a lot of thought, well, that, I think, basically is it. Just in a nutshell, the humor was a lot better, the acting, you know, the quality of the jokes, everything.
Yeah, overall, I really enjoyed this. I didn't have a chance to see Deadpool, the first one, in theaters. I generally do not like Ryan Reynolds, and I essentially abstained and boycotted seeing Deadpool. But after all the hype, once the Blu-ray came out, I caved, bought it, and I fell in love, and got really excited for Deadpool 2. Overall, I thought it was funnier. I did find the pacing a bit redundant, and of course the number of jokes they try to cram in this seems a bit inorganic as opposed to the first one. I don't know, I feel it's in a rock and a hard place though with that. It's stuck with trying to develop the mythos and the storyline for the character in film, meet the expectations of the first one but differentiate itself, and so it being a rated R comedy action superhero, I feel it navigates that pretty well without having any real examples to go off of and build off of, as opposed to any Marvel movie. They got a format that really works with the Disney Marvel studio. Some of the pros I got, definitely funny for the most part. SJ.
I don't know if I honestly didn't catch them, or I just don't quite remember them offhand. As much as I'm not a fan of SJWs, somehow my mind just doesn't reference back to the SJW jokes. Anyone that knows me, I kind of have a variety of humor. It depends on my mood, maybe even the day. I kind of, you know, try to mix it up. I kind of remember the more raunchy stuff, like the part where Juggernaut actually said, "I'm gonna shove the red one up the old one." I thought that was hilarious for some reason. I don't know why. But from what I remember, you know, kind of poking fun at the SJWs, because, I mean, in my belief system, nobody is ever entirely wrong, but to me, the SJW crowd definitely does take things a little too far, and regardless of what they think, they do need a taste of dose of criticism, like everyone does.
One of those jokes that really stood out to me that we talked about earlier that's, in my opinion, very meta and won't be taken that way for most people is the joke where Cable wants the, I'm assuming, Indian music turned off that Dope Ender's playing, and Deadpool instantly reacts like, "Oh, that's racist, you know, I hope you can change someday." And Cable's like, "I'm not a fucking racist." And Deadpool keeps it up, and then Domino, a black woman, ends up validating him, saying, "Oh, I actually agree with the old white guy." And I think, for me, that was funny because it speaks to the problem of SJWs, where if, you know, essentially white or males are offended or don't like something, whatever, their opinion doesn't matter. But if, essentially, they have to rope in a minority to agree with them to be valid. And I think that's what that joke was saying, that's why it blew me away. Another SJW joke, X-Force, things like X-Men, that's misogynist, you know, that's sexist.
Oh, right,
we're
right.
We're evolved from that now. yeah, I thought that was hilarious. Just showing how petty, you know, who complains about X-Men being called X-Men.
Right.
The whole joke, or the whole title is to be like, oh, we're another, we're mutants, you know. And it's a big analogy for being an other, whether it's racial or sexual or what have you. So I like how they show how petty a lot of these things end up being. Yeah, so the next topic that we liked, you talking about the diverse cast in there?
Oh yeah, definitely. It was definitely a very diverse cast without being on the nose. Without basically saying, hey, you know, you have to have diversity in that movie. And I kind of feel like the moral of it was more people of different backgrounds coming together for a common theme, which is the way it should be. As opposed to what SJWs try to do, they try to give that premise that they're coming together for the good of, but they're really definitely very divisive. There's definitely kind of this white men are evil sort of thing. Deadpool definitely did not do that. It was definitely, like I said, a very diverse cast coming together to solve a very real problem, so.
Yeah, I really appreciate it because you see with Disney especially, like Beauty and the Beast, the 2017 remake, they tried to champion themselves as, oh, representing gay people. We got the first purposely gay Disney character with LeFou. And, of course, you watch it, and it's just queer-baiting, and LeFou is an awful 80s, 90s effeminate stereotype of a gay man. It's insulting as a man, because I know gay men can be quite masculine. And I'm trying to think of some other examples of champion, however you say that, of really lauding themselves, praising themselves for representation. And Deadpool steers clear of that. They never, the only publicity was like, oh wow, Domino's gonna be a black girl. And that was very brief. They never jumped on people saying, oh, if you're questioning a white character being made black, you're racist or something, as opposed to Disney again with Star Wars and Finn, who ends up being a black space janitor, which ends up being pretty racist. I really appreciated that you know, a very vocal actor and Ryan Reynolds never stooped to that level and is very aware of that. And apparently, I'm not sure what the context were, but there were some Disney jokes that were omitted, probably because Disney thought they had the Fox purchase in the bag at the point that this was being made or about to come out.
One thing I found interesting too, and we were talking about this earlier, was, I mean, technically Domino was white, but she wasn't just white, like, you know, Caucasian. She was white. And I do believe she actually was, like, an alien race. So, I mean, technically, you can kind of say she wasn't even necessarily Caucasian, played by a black woman. You can say she was quite literally white. So, it's kind of interesting that people, you know, kind of took that turn. Not only because one thing I mentioned was I actually think Michael B. Jordan's portrayal of Johnny Storm in the newer Fantastic Four was better than Chris Evans. I quite frankly don't care that Michael B. Jordan was white. The actor did a better job, and that's what matters. And it's kind of reminiscent of the controversy that arose from the new Teen Titans movie about the actress playing Starfire being black. Starfire was kind of an orangish color, so it's, you know, why is it, you know, these people are saying Starfire was white, why are you having a black actress portray her? It doesn't technically make sense, so.
Yeah, I think it just shows the bad state of the media. Hopefully things like Deadpool will help mitigate that, or like Avengers, where no one cares that almost the whole cast is white, and they're not making a big deal about, oh, we're gonna have a big female fight or whatever. They just made a movie that everyone can get behind, because color doesn't matter when the characters are great. And the whole cast of Deadpool, even the stereotypical Asian girlfriend of a Negasonic teenage warhead, she was enjoyable. Don't really know what the angle was with her as far as this context with SJWs and whatnot, but overall, just a great diverse cast, and there's no virtue signaling. Another hilarious pro that we had, I think mainly Andrew, I was okay with it, but I think he really liked it, was the baby legs joke within this movie. You want to walk us into how that happens?
So basically, after Deadpool and Russell escape the prison, Russell decides to free the Juggernaut, and Deadpool comes across the Juggernaut and basically, you know, sees this partnership between the two. And basically, Deadpool was like a huge fan of the Juggernaut, and he's so struck by his fandom that the Juggernaut literally comes marching towards him saying, "I will rip you in half." And Deadpool doesn't seem to care, and Juggernaut picks him up and quite literally does rip him in half. So he somehow goes back to the apartment with Blind Owl, and he's regrowing the legs. And Cable comes in to be like, "I need your help, I can't do this alone." And there was a reference to Basic Instinct, which a lot of the younger viewers might not know that movie. There was a very iconic scene with an actress named Sharon Stone. She was, you know, kind of one of the more attractive women back in the day. And she's being questioned, I believe, by law enforcement. And she has this dress on. And during the interview, she's kind of sitting here like this. And at some point, to kind of try and distract the interviewer, she kind of slowly kind of does, you know, one of these numbers without actually wearing any underpants. So naturally, he can kind of see right up. And then she kind of teases him by crossing the other leg and kind of hiding it. And they did make reference to that at one point. Because, you know, of his disdain for Cable, Ryan Reynolds' character of Deadpool decides to do that and show his dick off to Cable, who is just like, "Is that really necessary?" And TJ Miller's character of Weasel goes, "It's his basic fucking instinct." And I immediately got the reference before, you know, Weasel said that. I definitely got the reference after he said that. And the interesting thing was, when I went to see the movie, I was in a theater full of teenagers, and there was maybe one that laughed. Perhaps he got the reference. Perhaps he just thought it was funny that Deadpool was showing his dick off to Cable and making him mad. I don't know. But the rest of the audience was just very silent. Like, they did not seem to get it whatsoever. So I just kind of, I not only found that reference humorous, but I just kind of thought it was funny that, I mean, I'm 34. These kids had to be 16, 17, 18, and just that age difference, just how easy it was for them to not get that joke, I kind of thought was humorous.
Yeah, I don't know, anytime I see things that are reminiscent of babies or little kids, the dad comes out in me, if it's done well, so I thought that was hilarious, just seeing this foul mouth, the merc with the mouth, having half his body be a baby, and then like, "Oh, he's taking his first step," and yeah, it's just hilarious that they're channeling this kind of parenthood moment with him just because of his baby legs. It was kind of retarded, but it was fun and stupid. I don't know, from the dad perspective, I guess it makes me think of Thor Ragnarok, where he's like, "Big monster," and, you know, he's got this, like, childlike reasoning to him that just shows, you know, makes him adorable, like a baby. another thing, moving on from that, another thing I really liked that was inconsequential for the movie, but was just funny as Deadpool is a fourth wall breaking, like, self-aware character, both in the comics and in the movies, the Spectre type intro for the movie, after the movie starts, gives you this kind of starting point. They move into this, what would you describe the tone as for the credits intro, as far as the music and how the setting was?
It was definitely very James Bond-esque. I didn't quite realize that at first because I've never been a James Bond fan. However, there is kind of an iconic scene in James Bond movies where, you know, you see the gun and you see the bullet travel from it. And Deadpool had its own take on that, where you see Deadpool very obviously as Deadpool, kind of doing this. And then another Deadpool is kind of posed on the fingertips, you know, kind of like semi-seductively as like one of the Bond girls. And that's when you kind of really start to get it. And then another very humorous aspect, in my opinion, of that, you know, that original credit scene is they very much addressed that there was just a death, but then they just automatically cut to this bizarre scene. And they were like, written by, wait a minute, did that just happen? Directed by, well, no, what the fuck just happened? And then it's like, the actors in this movie are, no, seriously, I want to know why, you know. And it was definitely a very humorous nod towards the James Bond movies, and kind of a good way to set up that this is an action movie, but it's also a comedy, and that he is very self-aware that he is in a movie.
Yeah, that intro, yeah, like you said, it reminded me of Spectre with the almost the same tone as the Writings on the Wall song by Sam Smith. I think Celine Dion did this music.
Yeah.
The credits, though, the actual, like, credits where they change instead of saying a name, it's like, oh, wait, this fucking happened. Like, no, wait. Wow, did they just kill her, and et cetera? Didn't feel as organic or natural as the first time. Yeah, it's really I gotta say about that was, there's certain things about this movie, the credits, some of the jokes, and I would say in general, Weasel are all very canned, very stale bits of humor from the first Deadpool that, it's how we learn. We try it again, didn't quite work, so we adjust. So I hope if there's a third one that they will adjust in these ways for these specific issues.
Yeah, because in a sense, it definitely was kind of a reused joke. They did put a little bit of a new paint job to it, but it definitely was still along the same lines.
Yeah, another just funny thing that we really liked about this movie was dirtying up Colossus. you know, both in his fight, he plays a bit dirty. That kind of goes against the character that's been set up in this film and in the previous one, that he's like trying to be the Boy Scout X-Men. You know, he's got his little book of like, oh, the first rule, don't kill people, and no matter what. And he, you know, towards the end, Deadpool gets him to say fuck reluctantly, and it was heartwarming in that moment. But it's funny how they've like humanized him a bit. I don't know how. I don't know, doctored that is, I guess, for lack of a better term, how canned that was, if they thought people are going to like Colossus if we keep them crystal clean, but I think they managed that really well. What are your thoughts on that?
I just kind of thought it was, basically what he said, it was just kind of funny, but it kind of was endearing, because the premise of it is that Wade Wilson was about to die, despite his powers. I don't want to give away necessarily too much of the movie, but, you know, there was kind of a way to kill him, and he was about to die. And even though Colossus is really kind of that Boy Scout, he was like, you know what, it's this dying man's last wish. I don't particularly care for this, but he did make a sacrifice, and did prove that he's a decent person. So, despite that, I will say this, and he just kind of, looks down and reluctantly goes, fuck. You know, because Deadpool thought it would be funny to hear him say it right before he goes, so.
Yeah, not only the, you know, getting him to curse, but they make you wonder about his sexuality, or how fluid, or, you know, whatever terminology you want to use. Because they repeatedly have Deadpool kind of come onto him, grab his ass. And then Colossus kind of saves the day by showing up, and Deadpool's like, oh boy. And you think, oh, is this a dream? Or, oh no, it's actually happening. And it's quite an affectionate way they film it, and in the way they interact. It's not blatantly obvious, but I don't know, that was kind of funny to, you know, maybe show Colossus in this way. Felt organic from Deadpool, that maybe he would have this corrupting influence.
Mm-hmm. I didn't necessarily derive that from it. I kind of derived more, he kind of just tolerated it.
That's what I like, is there's this middle ground of, oh, maybe he is fluid, and that could, you know, get be good PR points, virtue signaling, or it's just a way of showing, like, oh, he puts up with Deadpool.
It did kind of bring up one interesting point, though. I believe it was actually established in the Deadpool canon that Deadpool is pansexual. However, they did not really use that. Even in this kind of SJW intensive environment that we're in, they didn't really utilize that. So it was kind of interesting that I believe the girl's name was Yukio that was dating Negasonic Teenage Warhead. It's kind of interesting that they went that route, and maybe if he's correct and they did kind of, at least kind of imply that maybe, Colossus could at least be curious, if not just kind of low-key, you know, bisexual or gay, that definitely would be kind of an interesting turn, because, like I said, it was either definitely canon that he was pansexual, that Deadpool was pansexual, or there was, like, very strong theories of. And either way, you could definitely play that off to kind of appease the SJW crowd. But they definitely kind of went a different route. So that's definitely kind of interesting.
Yeah, just to build off that, I am going to school for psychology. Not well-versed yet, but I'm always thinking this route. And I'm wondering if maybe that was intentional, given the circumstance after Vanessa and whatnot, that maybe they used his sexuality to kind of show his grief stage, that he's just trying to cling to anyone. If he is pansexual, then him being pansexual might kind of borderline with demisexual, where he puts whoever he's interested in on a pedestal, and if they're gone, that's just devastating, and so maybe he's acting out sexually just to get some sort of love. And if that's the case, that's actually really deep for an action comedy that, you know, breaks the fourth wall every 5 seconds.
Or it could just be that Deadpool's a troll.
Yeah, there is an enigma to Deadpool. Next great point that we came to was showing luck with Domino, because she enters the movie and it's like, what's your power? It's like, I'm lucky. And it's like, luck's not a power. And they have this great back and forth to kind of show that they're on equal footing with each other. Neither one's going to back down. And when you hear that, you're thinking, how are they going to show someone's lucky? And they did that really well with the whole sequence of everyone is getting fucked up in the X-Force, and she drops down, luckily. And chaos starts ensuing with her parachute. Car hits a light pole falls, everything should be hurting her, but it's happening in sequence to aid her progression. And it happens throughout this whole chase sequence with Deadpool and Cable. And that was really funny, and it definitely, I'm not sure if you've seen John Wick, but I know the director's from John Wick, and it definitely had this kind of natural action progression like that. Different way of filming, whatnot, different storytelling, but it felt in very much capable hands the way they handled that. How did you feel about the whole sequence of luck with Domino?
It was definitely very interesting, and like you said, you could definitely tell that, you know, luck was definitely strong with her. I guess it technically could be argued if that's actually a superpower. And Deadpool kind of made that point by, you know, he's on the, like, a radio system with her, and he goes, I still don't get this. And she goes, I think she basically says, like, you're still kind of hung up on this, you know, what's the deal? And he goes, how is luck a superpower? Do you shoot luck beams? I mean, like, if you do, can you make someone else lucky and share in your luck? And, you know, all this while, like, she's driving and chaos ensues, and somehow she is completely unscathed. I mean, you got, you know, vehicles flipping. The people in that vehicle are more than likely dead. They crash into a building. They could have, you know, at least injured somebody in there, if not killed them. And at one point, kind of closer to the end of the movie, you know, she saves a bunch of kids, and she's like, we're going to need a bus. And a bus just happens to, like, come crashing through the wall. And she goes, well, there you go. And not only that, but kind of in a small sense, kind of, you know, in the luck, she kind of appeases the kids with the fact that the bus is kind of upside down and they're sliding, you know, the angle that the bus is at, they're sliding down the ceiling and they're like, whee! And I mean, they're just kind of happy with this whole situation. She's not having to calm them down or anything. So, it, you know, they definitely did do a very good job of kind of portraying her as definitely having a very, you know, a very strong aura, I guess, of luck, or just having a lot of luck, whatever the best way to word that would be.
Yeah, I'm actually, this is coming back to me because I saw it a day or two ago again. I totally forgot about the whole luck sequence in the before the bus comes in there, and God, it was very chaotic, and if it wasn't for it being a comedy, it'd be like very, I don't know, gut-wrenching, maybe? Mm-hmm. Very nauseating, I guess, the way some of the luck works out for her. It reminded me, one part at least, reminded me of the Million Dollar Baby joke where everyone keeps falling on the stool, snapping their neck, and just, they captured a scene like that, and it's like, oh God, this shouldn't be funny. Just gonna breeze through these really quick before we get on to more specific character development that we were interested in, but some things we agreed on in the movie were redundant. That would be, movie felt a bit repetitive of the first one, that the progression was very much using the skeleton of the previous movie, just plugging new events. We talked about this a little bit, but the title credit jokes, they didn't really land, so maybe they'll retool that or rework that, or focus more on that in the third one if they make one. And Russell being fat, this is one we talked about for about 20-30 minutes, because as you can tell, I'm definitely a pretty fat guy now, like I used to be, and Andrew owns his chub as well. So it's a dual-edged sword. Russell talks about it, kind of talks through the fourth wall, through Deadpool, about he wanted to be a superhero, but have you ever seen fat superheroes? And Andrew, he talks about the Blob a little bit. I forgot about him in X-Men Origins, but in general, you don't see fat superheroes, and we surmise that's because superheroes are supposed to be kind of like the Greek mythos. They're supposed to be prototypical, inspirational humanoids that they're setting a standard above our own, that we should be trying to aspire to be like one of them, to be like Superman or Deadpool or whoever. And so it's, you know, why would you want to be inspired to be a fat guy, you know, even if he's powerful? You know, you see that even in Mr. Incredible on The Incredibles, like, he works out to get back in shape, you know, he's lost his touch physically. They never really showed his body, but when he's older in the future, I assume he's thinner or more well-shaped, that he's kind of come into his body, perchance, or has amended his life. And overall, we're just thinking that it's a double-edged sword, walking this fine line of, yeah, it's nice to be bigger guys and see someone at least think this thought of, oh, it's nice to see a fat person be a hero instead of just being a villain or non-existent in this universe. But it's also, it can be problematic. Do you want to follow up on that?
Basically, like I said, it is kind of a double-edged sword. I mean, we talk about, you know, acceptance. And, I mean, acceptance, that it definitely is a good thing. Basically, my point earlier was, just because you're overweight doesn't mean that you should be picked on. You know, I talked with him about how I grew up in a small conservative town in Oregon. And I was the goth kid. And, you know, I got picked on for being different, but then I was also overweight. I think, weighed more back then than I do now as an adult. So I definitely got picked on a lot, and I don't think I deserved that, but I don't think the answer to that is basically kind of condoning people being overweight either. And I kind of likened it to, you know, if somebody had a drug problem, I would not condemn them for having a drug problem. However, I wouldn't be like, you know what? You don't listen to them haters. You snort that cocaine. Fuck them. You know, that's just not a good thing to do. And I mean, even as someone who is overweight, I do understand that being overweight is not exactly healthy for you. But it's just, there is that middle ground that we never seem to find. It's, you know, we seem to think that we should almost in a sense promote this sort of thing, and we really shouldn't. There definitely, you know, is a way to kind of be supportive without condoning bad habits. And I mean, just the animosity that comes from you know, you want to be this person, but you're not, but you have a choice. It's like, even as someone who is, you know, overweight, I do understand that I make choices of what I eat, what I do during the day. So if I see someone who's not in shape, you know, I don't sit there and get jealous of them. I don't hate them. So it's, there definitely is a middle ground with a lot of things that we never seem to find. So that's kind of what I mean by it's a double-edged sword. It's like, it is cool that they made someone who was overweight not even necessarily a hero. I mean, he kind of was at the end, but at first he wanted to be. And then some stuff happened, it jaded him, he kind of became the villain of the story, but then he came back around, and that's perfectly fine. But definitely find a means to be supportive of people without condoning their bad behavior would be, like, you know, the moral of all that.
Yeah, totally agree. It's kind of crazy, you know, I definitely love to see people's comments in the after we upload this about this topic. You know, it's trying to just breeze through that, and you see the kind of wormhole you can fall through just mm-hmm. discussing this briefly. So yeah, a couple cons, at least for me. Hated the color scheme. I would hope that they would, I don't know, maybe take a lesson from Thor Ragnarok and brighten up a bit. And this movie still follows the, I guess, tried and true X-Men color scheme of the gray-blue that X-Men has done for, what, 11 or 12 movies now? And I love X-Men. I actually like X-Men characters better than the Disney-Marvel movies, but they definitely grip you more. They get you to notice them with their color scheme, and it's like, Fox is just like, eh, whatever. Mm-hmm. And they keep using, like, the same camera filter or something. It's weird. Other con that we talked about would be the, when you first watch this movie, if you have no idea what's really going to go on, movie starts out, and it felt like an ADD type of movie. I thought, oh god, the direction is going to be completely different, and this is going to be the bomb, like, the rumors were going to be, or the rumors were about the initial screenings for this movie. Because he starts out and he's like knocking glasses over, and he's got toaster strudels, and he's just throwing them on the floor and smoking, and he's sitting on barrels of gas and shit with a cigarette, and it's like, what is going on? But it ends up going back in time to show you the sequence of events leading to that, and it remedies itself. But yeah, that intro was like an ADD moment. How'd you feel about that?
It definitely isn't one of those things that immediately makes sense. I don't know if necessarily ADD moment would be the correct term for me, but it doesn't make sense. However, it does kind of get you to think, because on the one hand, Deadpool is just kind of out there, just in a broad general term, and the intro to the movie was just kind of out there, so in a way it kind of fits his character, but at the same time, he definitely has a very good point. It's like, why is he just like, you know, a toaster strudel pops up and he happens to catch it and just toss it immediately? Because even for Deadpool, that is a bit strange. And then it just does kind of lead into the fact that he is very depressed about something. And then, you know, like you say, it definitely kind of explains. He even addresses it by breaking the fourth wall as usual, talking about, you're probably wondering why I'm on all these barrels, like, you know, smoking a cigarette. Well, you know, here's why. And I think the odd thing, though, is he explains after he blows himself up, and you literally see just chunks fly everywhere. So it's definitely, it fits the character, in my opinion. However, at the same time, it definitely is one of those things that kind of has you thinking, which, for most comedies, at least, is kind of strange. It's usually like, I'm here to just laugh, I'm not really here to think about things. It kind of accomplished both, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, I saw it twice, so at the same time I was prepared for it, but I was still critical. I'm like, this is a weird opening. Mm-hmm. And how he breaks the fourth wall is a bit different from the first one. And it's kind of, I'm in a weird state where it's like, at times I'm wanting them to channel the first one, but for the most part I'm wanting them to not channel that, but it still works out either way, so, yeah. Next one would be just there's a death sequence at the towards the end that's just like it's supposed to be a joke. It's like, oh, it keeps on, but yeah, it's definitely not rewatchable. You second time I watched it, I'm like, oh my god. Can we for, to get past this so you can see this resolution and the happiness? How'd you feel about that, your time seeing it?
I definitely agree. I mean, it did kind of spawn some really funny moments, like the aforementioned Colossus going, fuck. however, it definitely did drag on, and it fits the character. Deadpool can definitely be very trolly, but at the same time, it is kind of one of those you're looking at your watch like, dear God, this joke has gone on for like 5 minutes now. And I definitely would not consider that like one of the highlights of the movie, which is kind of a weird thing to say because, in my opinion, it spawned one of the highlights of the movie. However, it was not the highlight of the movie by any means, so...
Yeah, that was a bit painful to rewatch. Lastly, Weasel. Not Weasel in general, but during his baby leg scene, just this whole joking sequence, especially shirt cocking, that really got on Andrew's nerves.
Yeah.
I'll let him take that one away.
Originally, the joke wasn't all that funny. It is kind of a funny term. I get it. But it was repeated. At least, I want to say 3 times. And it's like, we get it. You have this quasi-funny term for Deadpool wearing a Hawaiian shirt with no pants on. But that doesn't warrant it being repeated. Like, yeah, it was just, it got old, so.
Yeah, so those were our quick takes on redundancy and the negatives of the movie. You want to go through some of the characters? Overall, I thought Deadpool was channeled a really good way with the powers he has. He has powers of regeneration. He blows himself out at the beginning, and he still won't die. He's talking to you with his blown-off head. Mm-hmm. And so it reminds me a lot of prequel shows and films that if you have a main character that you know where he's going to go, or if he's like Logan from Wolverine or whatever, that he won't die, you have to give him something to be concerned about for the plot to continue to work, or his living to be a problem. And in a comedy, they really handle that well. His whole progression felt organic to his set of circumstances, and it felt relatable even though it's completely unrelatable.
Yeah, I don't think I really have too much more nuance on that one. It just basically what he said. I mean, he is, I guess in a sense, kind of like a Superman or Wolverine sort of character. So, as somebody who can't really die, you either have to give him a reason to die, like Superman was given with Doomsday, or you have to give him something to care about that can die. And that kind of has to provoke them into action. However, that only technically kind of goes so far. I mean, you know, with like, let's just say Batman. I mean, Batman is in mortal danger. He has to overcome things. Deadpool, not so much. And I mean, they did give him a way to die. Like I said earlier, there was a way that, you know, he was killable. But, I mean, it wasn't throughout the whole entire movie. It was a brief period of time, and then he escaped that situation, and then he chose to go back into that situation to try and be with somebody who had passed away. So, I guess actually technically that last part I said really kind of doubles back to, you know, what you said is like, you have to give him something to care about. Otherwise, if he didn't care about anything and couldn't die whatsoever, he would just go on, his madness would probably build, and I guess at some point he would probably just kill everybody, and what real story do you have at that point?
Yeah, I think that leads me on to Cable. What were your thoughts about Cable, having just seen Avengers Infinity War, which is led by Josh Brolin, not even a month before, and they're both Marvel characters from two different studios using these characters?
I think Josh Brolin made a very good Cable. He also made a very good Thanos. I never really gave much thought or consideration into the fact that he's been in two Marvel movies. I was just looking more at the acting. And, I mean, there was a lot of controversy about Josh Brolin being Cable at first. A lot of people said he didn't have the build, which is fair. A lot of people were looking at Ron Perlman more for the build, but then even then at the same time, it's like, I don't know how much vocal range Ron Perlman really has. And vocally, I think his voice wouldn't really match up with the way that Cable's been represented in the past. And granted, you always have the option of trying to, you know, give him a different sound. I don't know how many people watching this video actually know this. At one point, Norman Reedus voiced the Punisher for a cartoon movie. And I like the Punisher, I like Norman Reedus, but dear God, no. That just didn't fit him at all. So, I mean, honestly, I think Josh Brolin definitely did a very good job of playing Cable, as well as Thanos.
Yeah, watching it, because I love Thanos, you'll know that if you check out my Philosophy of Thanos video. So, for me to see this character that I don't really know anything about, and having been treated to Brolin acting as a Marvel villain, and seeing him play someone who's kind of, an anti-hero for the most part, depending on how you want to tool him, I thought he handled that really well, that he took a back seat, and that's not in a bad, it's not a bad way to describe it. I thought he did really well, not letting his bravado take over the film or something, or stealing the show. I didn't know Ron Perlman was in talks for this. He definitely would have added a too comedic a role. Him being Hellboy would be too much in our minds if he was playing Cable, where it's like, oh, like, you're not really being Ron Perlman, you're, like, containing yourself. So that's enlightening for me to know that.
I don't think in the running. Ron Perlman was really in talks, but I did hear at least some people say that, you know, from just purely a physical build standpoint, which I can agree with. It's just like with Wonder Woman, I thought that, and I can't remember the MMA fighter's name, she played in the last Deadpool. She was one of the villains, Angel. I think build-wise, she definitely could have been a really good Wonder Woman, because, you know, she's definitely masculine and tough, but still feminine and attractive. So I think she would have, you know, done a very good job, not to negate how well Gal Gadot did, but, you know, I definitely think she would have been a really good choice. So it's just kind of one of those things, like, everybody's going to have their perspective. And the correlation is basically just from a purely physical stance. Not really looking at, like, acting chops or, you know, vocal range or any of those things that also factor in. Just looking at it on the surface level. I think a lot of people were really kind of hoping for Ron Perlman. It's just like, I don't know how many people know this, but I believe it was Joaquin Phoenix was originally supposed to be Doctor Strange. And I saw actual images of him in the Doctor Strange outfit, and to my mind, he looked a lot like it, so I was really rooting for him. And then I heard Benedict Cumberbatch, and I was like, I don't know. But then, honestly, I think Benedict did an awesome job as Doctor Strange, so.
We're talking about Domino a little bit more. We talked about her being black, of course, but how'd you feel about her in Yellow?
Basically, I, again, never really cared about the controversy over her skin color. I think she fit the bill very well because while I'm not entirely familiar with the character of Deadpool, I just kind of love him more for the sarcasm and the witty humor and whatnot. To my knowledge, the relationship that was presented between Deadpool and Domino in the movie was very accurate. And the actress, Zazie Beetz, she did a really, you know, a really good job of portraying the character, I mean, at least to my knowledge. And, you know, regardless of skin color, I mean, Domino was seen as being attractive to a lot of, you know, people. And Zazie Beetz is definitely a very attractive woman. So, honestly, I had no problem with her portrayal of Domino. So I really don't see what the big deal is. You know, I kind of hate to throw labels at people, but I almost think a lot of people maybe didn't like her just out of racism. It's very possible. Maybe I'm missing something. But, I mean, it definitely does kind of seem like it's one of those things that's not a big deal by any regards. It's, you know, more the fact that she has the acting chops to portray her. And, you know, the chemistry between her and Deadpool. And that's, at the end of the day, that's all that really matters, so.
Yeah, talking about attraction, it's probably just a minor thing, but as a black kid, I grew up, now I'm bald, but I used to have a big nappy fro, and I loved it, and I always hated growing up realizing that black women essentially suppress their wild hair, their ethnic display, to fit a societal norm, straight hair and whatnot, not saying mm-hmm. white or black, whatever, but they, in that way, suppress themselves, and it's nice, and I like that having had a fro as a kid. She had a quality about her that was just, like, felt fresh. She felt like whenever she was having dialogue with Deadpool or whoever, that there was a natural chemistry or energy in the room, and definitely like to see more of her going forward. I think she's in Atlanta, I think it's the show. Definitely haven't seen that yet, but having seen Deadpool, I am at least intrigued to see anything she's in now.
All right, well, we had to kind of cut the video short. There was only so much space on the phone for recording. But definitely like and subscribe if you like what you saw here. And if you like gaming videos, please check out my channel, Deneous Blaylock, DeneousBlaylock. I mainly do a lot of fighting games on there. I'm kind of breaking out into different things. I'm thinking about maybe kind of doing some social commentary stuff and whatnot. At the moment, my idea is just a brief synopsis because we're kind of running out on time. There was a video by someone named Scare Theater talking about targeted individuals, people who believe they're targeted by the government. We were going to kind of further analyze that. So if you definitely think that would be something you'd be interested in, please let me know. I was thinking about getting this guy in on it if you wanted to, so.
Yeah, given time constraints with school and my own interests in videos, that might be a thing in the future to look forward to. Definitely had fun making this video. We actually used to work at Walmart together, so that's how we know each other. Be sure to like and subscribe my channel, Black Angus Reviews. My channel is concerned with NFL, film, and philosophy, and how they can all intertwine potentially. So, yeah, thank you for viewing.
'll be coming for your love, okay, and take on me, take me on. I'll be gone in a day. To say I'm odds and ends, but that's me, I'm stumbling away, slowly learning that life is okay, and say after me, it's no better to be safe than sorry, and take on. Thank you. and all things that you say. Is it life or just to play my worries away? You're all the things I've got to remember. You're shying away. I'll be coming for you anyway. Take on me. Take me on. I'll be gone in a day. In a day or two.